This is a talk about kind of where are our studies going and our thinking going with respect to try to understand what actually happens when students use lean. So for those who were here last time, the talk last time was more focused on trying to think whether some of the skills the students acquire when they interact with Lean can be transferred to what they do when they write proofs in a traditional way on pen and paper. But the focus of this talk is on the study that we are presenting today is slightly different. Can you scroll next? So we have a lot of... we have a lot of studies that, of course, talk about students' engagement with mathematical proofs and with the difficulties. This research has gone on, I want to say, since the end of the 70s. So it's not really a new field and is currently going on and looks at mostly conceptual difficulties with producing proofs, which involve difficulties with proof writing, with conceptualizing proofs, with understanding logical implications and all these things. So this is one of the bases of our research. The second point that we wanted to make today is that the modules that include programming have become more frequent than they were 10 years ago. So in a replication study that I did with my colleague Adrian Simpson at Durham, we compared the number of like the distribution of module and the assessment in UK universities 10 years ago and today, 2019, and not quite today. And we found that actually there are more modules that have programming inside. So these modules tend to look like computational modules, so mathematical modeling modules in the first year of university, mostly. And some universities have them also for further years. And the most common programs that are used are Maple, Python, R for statistics, not so much programming for pure mathematics. And because this move into introducing programming into mathematics degree is relatively new, there is quite a lot of calls in the world where Athina and I belong to try to understand what is the impact of the use of programming on students learning mathematics. So in some way, our research on using Lean falls into this call for trying to understand how this impacts the learning of mathematics in this particular case, in the case of Lean, learning of proof. So there have been quite a lot of movement since Lean has started to be used for teaching. So the first thing I read, I think it was Jeremy's paper in 2019 that described his experience of teaching Lean with Lean. I think it was a logic course with Lean. And I was particularly interested in this paper, in the point that Jeremy makes that this teaching helped the student, for example, understanding the difference between natural language, technical language, and technical mathematical language, which is one of the problems that we know exist when students kind of progress through to university studies. Then Gila and Kitty, who are here with us, have very recently wrote, a theoretical paper that talks about how interactive theory improvers can support the learning of mathematics and the learning of proof. And they have some really good examples in the paper they've written. So people are also asking themselves the questions, can we see reasons why this could be something desirable? So is there a role for interactive theory improvers in the teaching of mathematics and what this role could be? Last year, Athina and I talked about a paper where we discussed the transferability or otherwise of skills which were acquired while programming Lean, things like goal setting improves or writing proof writing, so precise proof writing. And also in the same study, and this is a paper which has just come out, we discuss what were the attitudes and the perceptions of the students with regarding this programming language. So how did they position themselves with respect to this, to the use of Lean? What were the things that they thought were beneficial to them, and what were the things that they thought were not so beneficial, and what were the problems that they saw that came out in the module where they encountered Lean? The most interesting thing, I think, in this study, which we're not particularly going to talk about today, is that we noticed that students talked to us about the impact that coming to know how something like an interactive theorem prover operates has on their perception of what is mathematics and what do we mean when we say rigor in mathematics, which is something that, again, we know is a bit problematic, especially in the transition into university studies. And we often talk about the fact that students need to change their epistemological beliefs in regards to mathematics. So they need to go from a perception of mathematics as cool, where mathematics is calculation and application of algorithm, to a more advanced perception of mathematics. So this is where we are today. Today we are going to focus about something different. So the focus today is on the use of the tool. So we know that a proof in Lean can be written in very many different ways, and the students may decide to use tactics, to not use tactics so much, to do other things. We have asked ourselves the questions, what are the implications of the different way in which students write proofs in Lean? Can we see that there are different ways in which students write proofs in Lean? And can this difference tell us something about what the students, in the way in which the students use this tool, but also the way in which the students learn about the proofs? And is there an implication in the way that we can, is there a connection, if you like, between the way in which students write proofs in Lean and their beliefs about mathematics? And I hand on to Athina now, who is going to tell us all about the study.
Thank you very much, Paola. So the context of our study was a first year pure maths module with a usual duration of like 12 weeks, where they saw the mathematical content they saw was sets, function, logic, proof. So you see here kind of elementary number theory, topology, but they also saw groups, vector spaces, and so on. So the lecturer who was teaching this module designed and used similar games to the natural number game that we heard briefly about yesterday, and we're going to see in more detail a little bit later in our slides, and also created lecture notes that introduced Lean to the students as well. So in terms of teaching, there were hourly lectures and weekly seminar classes. But Lean was not a compulsory part of the module at that particular time. There were optional Lean sessions on Monday mornings, and students had the opportunity to engage if they wanted to with Lean in that particular module. In terms of the data collection that we did, we interviewed students, and we focused on, it was optional, so we didn't have a lot of students that were actually willing to be speaking to us about this, but we found four very, very keen ones though. So in the first interview, what we did was we gave a half-coded Lean proof to the students, and they were asked to solve it while thinking aloud, and you see the half-coded proof here. Then the next task they had to do was they were asked to prove a task on pen and paper first, and then prove the same task in Lean. We also followed these kind of first initial interview with multiple interviews with the students, where the students were asked to go through levels of the natural number game, and they were asked to share their screens and use Think Aloud protocol so that we were able to hear what they were thinking. We were also prompting them to share with us a little bit more what they were thinking while solving different levels. And as Paola mentioned, our focus now was on seeing what are the different ways that students engaged with Lean. My animation is a bit problematic here, so apologies. So this was the task that they were asked to prove in their first interview. So now we're going to share with you what they were doing in the follow-up interviews that we did. And I just wanted to share with you that these four students were very, very keen. We were doing the interviews throughout the summer last year, and they were fully done with their modules and everything, and they had a lot of time to give us. So we have about 10 hours of video recorded interview with each of the students. And we're very, very thankful for giving us so much of their time. So we're going to focus today on two participants. We have given them the names Gemma and Matt, and we're going to see them solving one level of the advanced proposition world from the natural number game. And this is the statement that they had to prove. As we mentioned earlier, our goal was to explore the different ways that these two students engaged with Lean to prove this particular task. So for quite a few of you, this the natural number game is very familiar, but we decided to do just a little bit of a brief introduction to it. So the natural number game, you'll see here a screenshot of it. And huge thanks to Kevin and Mohammed for creating this, because it has been a very useful tool as well for us in terms of data collection, as well as, of course, fulfilling it, the purpose of introducing Lean to quite a lot of new users. So the game has quite a lot of different worlds, addition world, multiplication world, function world, and so on. And we've decided to focus today on the advanced proposition world. So we're showing you here one of the levels. So this is level 4 of the advanced proposition world. So you see that the level is kind of structured. You have like 3 different sections within your screen. In the main section of the screen, you have where the task that the student has to prove this particular lemma. And you have the section where you can be writing your code. There are also buttons that take you to the main menu or the previous level if you wanted to go back and check your progress there. You also have the opportunity to reset or move to the next level if you want it. And you have also the opportunity to check previous tactics and theorem statements. So this has been very useful in terms of the tactics and the theorem statements for the students. And I think yesterday, Gihan was sharing whether this would be possible to be added in other environments where students are using Lean. Because what is useful is that you have within the theorem statements and within the tactics, all the tactics and theorem statements that the students have engaged with so far, with a brief example of how they're used and what are they doing. So they don't necessarily need to recall, but they can just open that and check what's happening. So this is the statement. And as I mentioned, the interviews took place in the summer. The students were familiar with the mathematical content of that particular proof and with the tactics that appeared earlier in the natural number game. Some of the interviews were like from one day to the next, whereas other interviews took, like we did like our interviews weekly. So it really depended on the availability that the student had. And we are going to be focusing, as I mentioned earlier, on the ways that students use Lean. So we have the task again, and the reason that I want to illustrate the task here with you once more is to essentially share with you that prior to the lemma, the students are given some information about the mathematical statement, And they're also given some hints as to which tactics they should be using. So the tactics cases, split, and intro, H, are mentioned at this particular text prior to the proof. So we're going to look at what Gemma did. So Gemma initially engaged with a text of this particular level, shared that she was actually expecting to see the split tactic being used because it is an equivalent statement. So she was expecting that she would have to use that. And she was constantly engaging with what was her goal, her context, and also the error messages that she was getting. I will share with you one of the instances from her coding where she received an unexpected response from Lean. So this is her code here. And she had in her context R, and she had a goal of P. So she shared here while she was explaining to me what she was doing. And then again, I have the goal of Q and I have the statement that P implies Q. So I'm going to write apply PQ. But then she suddenly realized that this is a random goal. So she shouldn't be kind of thinking about this particular goal, but she should have been proving something different. So she said afterwards that I need to apply QP to be able to get to the goal that she wanted. Then later on, we see her essentially fixing her code and completing the tasks. So I've highlighted here the aspects that changed in her code and her task. And this is her kind of final proof. What she shared with me was that she was very kind of hasty in splitting up the statement. So she was reflecting afterwards with her code that it took a lot more lines than she was expecting. So she shared that she would have done something differently. And instead of kind of splitting the different parts, I might have thought about the bigger statements and how to utilize those a little bit more. So now I'll take you to what Matt did in his proof. So Matt engaged with with a text of the level. He was always reading out loud the text. So it's a very different to what Gemma was doing. So Gemma was reading the text, but was not actually reading it out loud, and reflected very briefly on the statement and said actually that the statement says use intro H, but shared, well, I'm not going to do an intro H because I want to do intros H1 and H2. As there are two implications, and I want to do it to simplify things quite a lot more. And then I will also focus on one incident from Matt's coding. So initially Matt wrote intros H1, H2, and then wrote split, and then cases, as you can see in his code here. However, he saw this in his kind of context and goals, which was not really what he was expecting. So he said, well, if I'm splitting here, it actually applies only to a particular goal. So he is moving the split tactic instead of having it on the second line of his code to the fourth line of his code to allow for that tactic to carry on to the whole context rather than to just one of these. So in the way that Matt was coding, not just at this level, but in his other levels as well, he was very easily kind of moving lines of code around and so on. So here you see the final proof that Matt did. And he was very, very excited by using repeat and CC tactic. So the CC tactic is the congruence closure tactic. And what Matt was saying here was that CC is quite nice, because you kind of close quite a lot of implications, as you can see in his quote. So if we have a brief look at the different proofs that Gemma and Matt produced for the same statement, we see that the length is very different from them, but also Matt uses quite a lot of shortcuts, I would say, compared to Gemma. And we saw that this was the case for them, not just in this level, but also in the other levels as well. So kind of concluding our results for these two particular students, we saw that both students actually engaged with the features of Lean, the breaking down of the proof, the structuring, the feedback, the error messages as well. However, the way that they engaged was very different. We see that Gemma used Lean as kind of a step-by-step verification. She was also very closely thinking to how she would write her proof on pen and paper and how she could translate that to Lean code. Whereas Matt had a slightly different kind of way of engaging with Lean, and he was also sharing quite a lot that this is kind of a game. So he would move as parts of code, as I said earlier. He would use what he called the kind of the shortcuts or cheating cheating. This was one of the few things that he shared in terms of how he engaged with the tactics that would solve multiple goals in one way. And what we are now doing is we are realizing that we don't know quite a lot in terms of how students engage with Lean. This was just an initial step. What we want to do further is to think about the learning implications that these ways of using Lean might have on these students in terms of their learning of mathematics, their learning of proof. But also, as Paola mentioned earlier, we're interested in the epistemologies. So these students are engaging with a slightly different, mathematics in a slightly different way. And we want to see what kind of impact this might have on their epistemologies as well. And with that, hopefully I'm within the time. And I would like to say a huge thank you, especially to colleagues who allowed us to study their modules. And of course, the students who gave us so much of their time. And we're also looking forward to further collaborations as well.